If you love liberty, declare your independence by signing the Shire Society Declaration at shiresociety.com.
All right. Good afternoon at this point, everybody. Thank you for coming out today, and what an honor to be here at the third annual Anarchapulco. I'm Ian Freeman. For those of you who aren't familiar with me, I figure I should explain to you who I am and why I'm qualified.
But we are not related.
Well, we could be. We're all kind of related in some way. Why am I qualified to tell you why you should move to New Hampshire as soon as possible? So I moved to New Hampshire back in 2006, so over a decade ago. I've had a little bit of experience doing activism there. I've been arrested a few times here and there. Done a lot of media production. I've been very, very deeply involved in the New Hampshire activism community. Many of you might be aware that there is an active migration of people like us, people who believe in freedom, who are moving to New Hampshire. They've been doing it for more than a decade. There are thousands of libertarians, voluntarists, anarchists, people who love liberty, who have made that move, and I've been pretty deep in that community. So I think I know a thing or two about it, and I can speak to that. So first of all, the one reason why, there's a bunch of reasons, there's no way I can cover them all in a short period of time we have together, so I'm going to focus on what I consider to be some of the more important ones. Number one, New Hampshire is already the freest of the United States. It was ranked that way by the Cato Institute, the Freedom of the 50 States study that came out very recently, and it was number one. So it's already the freest place. It's an easy place to open up a business, it's an easy place to get settled. There's a lot of really good things about New Hampshire. The government there, compared to other governments in the United States, is very small. In fact, I think the percentage of like bureaucrats to population is relatively low compared to other states. It's called the Granite State. The people there are very independent-minded people, very freedom-minded people. You may have heard their state motto, live free or die. Okay, it's a good one. It's a good state motto. Now, it's just a motto. Obviously, there's a state in New Hampshire, and they still do state-like things, like putting peaceful people in cages for possession of land. But we're seeing some changes on that front, too. And there's a lot of like political change that I can touch on here in a little bit. So already, the state of New Hampshire has this sort of live free or die mentality. The people who were born there, a lot of them were raised around guns. Even the Democrats have guns in New Hampshire. Okay, so it's hard to explain, you know, the differences between New Hampshire and the rest of the United States and the rest of the world. But it really is truly a special place. So it's already a free place, and there's a lot of opportunity there, a lot of economic opportunity. It's the best economy of the Northeast. Well, that's because it's already the freest place. So, of course, you know, businesses are more likely to locate themselves there. People have been moving there for decades before the active migrations, like the Shire Society or the Free State Project. Before there were those things, there were already people who care about freedom and who recognize that New Hampshire was that special place. And they've been moving there. So the native population, they're good people, and they're very independent-minded, very freedom-minded people. People who really believe in leaving their neighbor alone to live their life how they want. That's sort of the, natural mentality of the folks there in New Hampshire. So one of the big reasons to make this move as soon as you possibly can is because, well, there's already thousands of us there. There's the largest community of like-minded, liberty-oriented people in the world in New Hampshire. People who have picked up their lives, as I did, I used to live in Florida, lived there for 26 years. People who picked up their lives and have moved to this other place, to this cold place. And we'll talk about the weather as well, because that's certainly the number one objection. But the community there of liberty-minded people is unmatched. You know, if you think the vibe in this conference at Acapulco is wonderful and amazing, imagine that 52 weeks out of the year. Okay, you can have that in New Hampshire. Now, obviously, people have to work. We can't just all have a conference every single day of the year, but you're around the same kind of people. I was talking to some somebody the other night in the airport about, you know, why they're coming to the conference, what they're excited about. I love being around all these minority people. I can talk to people about my ideas. Because a lot of people, you know, where you live, you might not have very many freedom-oriented friends. You know, in Florida, there were a handful of libertarians. And I don't know how many of them were voluntarists. So we don't have very many people that, you know, that we feel comfortable talking to about our ideas where we live. In New Hampshire, that's not a problem. In New Hampshire, you can have as many libertarian, voluntarists, anarchist friends as you want. There are so many of them there, you can't even possibly know who they all are. It's impossible to know. There's so many. So what that results in is just incredible community, an incredible level of support. Perfect example of that is when somebody arrives in New Hampshire, you let us know when you're coming. Just say, okay, we're moving into this town, we're coming on this date, we're going to be at this location. And then a dozen people will show up and help you unload your moving truck. Now, these people you've probably never met in your entire life, and they've come to help you move into your house. It's an incredible feeling, and all you've got to do is maybe bring some beers and order some pizza to a local pizza place. And we've had entire 26-foot trucks, moving trucks, packed to the brim with equipment and furniture and things like that. We've had those things unloaded in less than an hour. Just crank it out. People took a day to load the truck. Took an hour or less to unload it. So that's a good example of how people can come together in New Hampshire to help each other out in a way that is just oppressive. That doesn't happen anywhere else. So you know, this community that gets involved in so much. There's so much activism that you can do with these folks. You know, some people want to go out and they want to cop block. Pete, for instance, the founder of Cop Block, is in this room. He lived in Keene with the community. So you can cop block. There's a lot of that support out there. There's a lot of political action. People are running for political office and winning. That's happening in New Hampshire, where libertarians are actually winning. I'll touch on that here in a little bit. There's also, you know, like community activists kind of things, like, you know, social activism. People will help feed families around Thanksgiving with an organization called Shire Share. So whatever it is you want to get involved in, there's a lot going on in New Hampshire. In fact, there's more happening probably in 1 week in New Hampshire than happened like in a year where I'm from in Florida. There's more than you could possibly get involved in. Which is nice because you can pick the things you really like. You can pick the things that are the most interesting to you, the ideas, the groups that call to you the most. You want to get involved in gun rights activism? Good place to do it. We just had constitutional carry passed this week in New Hampshire. Now, constitutional carry, as you don't know, is where you can conceal carry a weapon. Open carry has been legal for years in New Hampshire, but you can conceal carry a weapon now without asking any government bureaucrat for permission in New Hampshire. So that's great news. And that happened because of the the activism. That happened because of the people who were there who are working to change the system. And I know, you know, there's a bunch of anarchists in the room. We don't really believe in the system and changing the system, but it's there, unfortunately, and there are a bunch of people who believe it, specifically men with badges who aren't afraid to put people in cages for breaking those system's rules. So if we can change that system, then we should. If we can stop those men with badges from arresting people for having a concealed weapon or for having a plant in their pocket, we need to stop that from happening. And that's something that people are working towards in New Hampshire. Because concentration matters. You know, we know what it's like to be here at this conference with so many great people who care about freedom, that feeling of that synergy, of feeling like, wow, you know, it's great not only to be able to talk to these people, but to actually work with them. Boy, imagine if we could get this whole conference to move to the same place and actually live there and work to make things better. That would be even more impressive than just getting up on stage and speaking. I'm not saying that's not important, but there's a lot more that we can do as a community. So, you know, I think New Hampshire is proof, and the activism. example of that is the political successes that we've had that have resulted in opposition. Now, they say that you don't take flak until you're over the target. There's a classic phrase that first they ignore you, then they laugh at you, then they fight you, then you win. We're at the fight you stage in New Hampshire. Libertarians, voluntarists, anarchists, they're in the ignore you stage pretty much everywhere else. Anybody here ever been involved in a libertarian campaign? Anyone here? Yeah, just a few people. Let's just shout it out. What's the percentage of vote that a candidate got?
0.23%?
Sounds about typical. 4% is actually really good. It's a good campaign. Okay, well, you did well for a libertarian. Well, mostly it's 2% or 3%, so. Alright, fair enough. You've convinced me. But in New Hampshire, the Libertarian Party has barely existed. They're actually just now really kind of coming into their own. It's kind of dead for a while. So libertarians will run as Republicans and Democrats and get elected. Anarcho-capitalists. I'm not just talking about like half-ass Republican libertarian types. I'm talking about principled, voluntarist people who are getting elected in New Hampshire. Just in 2016, there were, I think, 18 or more like Free State Project participants, principled people who were elected to the state house. Now there's 400 state reps, so there's quite a few these state representatives, which is actually a good thing. And it means that the amount of power each of them has is very, very small. They get paid $100 per year. Now, in most state representatives, they're probably, you know, in your state, if you live in the United States, they're probably getting paid, you know, $20,000 to $70,000 per year. They've got staffs of people. These guys get a lot more. That's what they get. They don't have a desk. They don't have a clerk, they have a lawyer. That's all they get, $100 a year, and a gas stipend. So not a whole lot. This is really like a volunteer gig almost for these folks. So it kind of keeps away the professional politicians, it keeps away the lawyers, which we're used to seeing running for political office elsewhere. It also makes it so you can talk to these people. These literally are your neighbors. They live near you. Each person in New Hampshire, because New Hampshire has a population of only 1.4 million. So of those 400 state reps, you can do the math, it comes down to like 3,000 to 3,500 people that they represent. And we all know they don't really represent us. But it's different when you can actually like call them up. And there's a little kid that answers it like, hey, can you put mom on? I mean, you're calling them at their home. You're calling them on their cell phone. They're not protected by the police. They're not protected by gatekeepers. Even the governor of the state only has one cop. That's, you know, his security detail. That's it. New Hampshire's a very kind of small government-minded place. So political success is not only, you know, we see people getting elected in New Hampshire and actually working to roll back that government, like with this concealed carry that just happened. But the level of success that we're having has resulted in political enemies. We have opposition. I'll give you a good example. There's a group called Granite State Progress, and each time there's an election, so it's every 2 years, by the way, New Hampshire, so the whole state house, the governor, every 2 years there's an opportunity to turn the whole thing over. So every time there's an election, for the last two or three times, this Granite State Progress group has really done their homework. They want to know who the Free Staters are. Who are the libertarians who are running as Republicans and Democrats so they can out them publicly in the hopes that that will somehow harm their campaign. We've had people, these anti-freedom organizations, these haters, for lack of a better term, they printed up full-color flyers, mailed them to houses in an entire political district to let people know, hey, this person wants more freedom. I mean, they literally will advertise. They're paying thousands of dollars to print full-color flyers to talk about how scary it is that we want to get the government out of people's lives. I mean, we can't ask for better enemies. We really can't. It's incredible. So, how many people running a libertarian campaign have ever had opposition to the campaign? If you're running a libertarian campaign, you're lucky if you can get into a debate. You're lucky if the newspaper will run an article about your candidate. We are ignored all over the place, but in New Hampshire, we're definitely not ignored. In fact, they know that we're a threat, and they are afraid of it. There was a state representative from Keene years ago, this was 2012 now, so 5 years ago, who said that the free staters, I think was the term she used, is sort of this pejorative, negative term that the haters use towards freedom-oriented people, the free staters. She said, quote, the single greatest threat to the state. How many times, thank you, how many times has that ever been said about the Libertarian Party anywhere? Yeah, I get it. Zero to that. You are correct, sir. Zero. Now, that's not to say that the Libertarian Party is a bad organization, although they're not really that great. Fielding some terrible candidates over the years, but what an honor to be called the greatest threat to the state, single greatest threat to the state, and she's right. And we are, because we are against the state, and there are more and more of us coming all the time. We just had a guy move in the middle of the winter to Keene, New Hampshire. Yeah, a dozen people came out on a brittle cold morning. It was not comfortable moving all that furniture into his new pad, but, you know, we did it. And he's a professional. He works with a professional wholesale grocer. I mean, we've got professionals, we've got families, single people, couples, all kinds of folks are showing up. They're getting involved in the things that they think are the most interesting and attractive. So concentration matters. Why does it matter so much? Well, I can tell you, I used to be an activist in Florida. I used to be the lone guy standing on the side of the road with a honk if you pay taxes sign. I got a lot of honks, but nothing ever changed. It wasn't like there were a bunch of people who were coming up to me, or you know, I used to do outreach booths at the county fair in Florida, you know, other places, gun shows, gay and lesbian pride fest. I'd find libertarians all the time. We'd do the world's smallest political quiz. There are all these libertarians here, great. Not a single one ever came out to any kind of meeting. There was never any real change. The votes for the libertarian candidates never went up. As long as we're the lone voice in the wilderness yelling out there, freedom! Hey, you guys want some freedom? Most people don't want it. They want to be told what to do. They want to feel safe. They want the government out there protecting. And some of those people still live in New Hampshire, but there's overall that sort of freedom mentality in New Hampshire that you just won't find in other places. And so we can concentrate our numbers in one geographic area, then freedom will become more popular. And eventually, once freedom becomes more popular, then the crowd will come along. Right? The Me Too's, like all these people who just kind of out there living their lives. Once libertarians and voluntarists start getting and changing things to be more freedom oriented, everybody's going to say, oh yeah, I always agree with those guys. I have always been on board. Freedom. But we can't get to that point until we have the numbers. And that's why I need you to consider making a move to New Hampshire. Because really, what are the prospects for liberty where we live? Be honest with yourself. Think about it later on tonight. Are you seeing tremendous growth? Are you seeing opposition to what you do? Do you have haters? I certainly do. And the New Hampshire Liberty Movement certainly does. We get news coverage all the time in New Hampshire. There's frequently mainstream media, television, radio, newsprint that covers what libertarian activists are doing in New Hampshire. We're newsworthy because we're making a difference, because we're making an impact. Libertarians elsewhere, sorry, not newsworthy. Nobody wants to talk about you elsewhere. I wish that wasn't the case. I wish we had this burgeoning movement where we could easily, you know, change things, but it's not happening because we don't have enough of us in one place. In New Hampshire, we're just getting started. It's been a decade into this, you know, the Free State Project. They started moving people back in 2003. There's also the Shire Society, which is a more decentralized community. It's, you know, there's no board of directors to make stupid decisions. There's all kinds of folks coming. Let me give you another example of the incredible community that we have. Do we have any Bitcoin or cryptocurrency fans in the audience here? Okay, excellent. I live in Keene, New Hampshire, which when I did the math recently, you go to coinmath.org and you can look and see, you know, how many different businesses there are that accept Bitcoin in one geographic area. They say if you look up the top Bitcoin accepting areas of the country or the world, San Francisco's number one. But Keene actually has a greater concentration, a greater per capita, businesses accepting Bitcoin per capita than San Francisco. And that's because we've got a really good activist movement there. We've got Bitcoin activists. People like me will go out to a business and ask a business owner, hey, are you taking Bitcoin yet? No, what's that? Well, here's some information. We've got cards, propaganda cards, got like a business pitch sheet that explains why Bitcoin is such a great option, why it's like a, almost like a local currency in a lot of ways, and that it can keep money in a community. And then when one business owner is accepting Bitcoin, there's a little corner shop on the corner news that's been taking it since 2013. You walk into corner news, you want to buy a pack of cigarettes with Bitcoin, you want to buy a drink, you can buy anything in the store, you want to buy a pipe. They'll sell it to you for Bitcoin. And then the owner of that store might take that Bitcoin and go across the street to a place called Local Burger, and she might buy lunch with that Bitcoin. So again, it's kind of got that cool little Bitcoin economy in a local area. So we know Bitcoin's international, but it also can function as a local currency. So that's one of the ways that it's pitching it there. And so we just recently got a car repair place taking Bitcoin, which is a big deal if you think about it, right? Because, you know, buying a piece of pizza or whatever with Bitcoin, that's not a huge ticket. But repairing a $1,000 repair on your car where you can pay with Bitcoin, that's pretty cool. So, you know, we got a cool Bitcoin community there. And it's not just in Keene, it's all across New Hampshire. I mean, the Lamasu Bitcoin vending machine was invented in Manchester, New Hampshire. The world's first ever Bitcoin vending machine. It's a good one. So lots of Bitcoin people, lots of opportunity. Oh, have you guys heard of the New York Bit License? Terrible Bit License. You know, that that thing drove businesses out of New York. The Bitcoin vending machines in upstate New York shut down. So guess where all the New Yorkers come to buy their Bitcoin? That's right. Well, there's still some machines in New York City, but New York City is the only part of New York State that has Bitcoin vending machines. So everyone from upstate New York, if they want to buy the Bitcoin, they come over to Keene. There's 5 Bitcoin vending machines across all of New Hampshire. In fact, there's more Bitcoin vending machines in New Hampshire than the rest of New England combined. The only other place with Bitcoin vending machines in New England is Boston. So we've got an incredible community of Bitcoin lovers who are working both inside the system and outside the system. There are people who accept Bitcoin and who are Bitcoin advocates who are state representatives in New Hampshire. So instead of having to, like, you know, try to convince the state to not crack down on Bitcoin, we actually already have people who are state reps who are active with Bitcoin. And some of the headlines you've seen recently were somewhat misleading about New Hampshire and the legal status of Bitcoin. It's true that there is something that passed last year that there's one company called Poloniex that pulled out of doing business with people in New Hampshire, and that got all these headlines like, New Hampshire's regulating Bitcoin! Not really. What happened was Poloniex wanted it to be regulated. So they want the state to give them some sort of permission slip, which they don't need if they want to do business in New Hampshire. And
That's how we came out of that. But there was something that was put into state banking regulations about convertible virtual currency. And, you know, it was in the money transmitter section. And so this year, there's actually a bill that's been put forward after there was a Bitcoin committee that was formed. Of course, there were Bitcoiners, including myself, and we testified to this committee, and we helped educate them on what Bitcoin was. I know working within the system sucks, but at least they will pay attention to you in New Hampshire. Some of them will actually listen to you. They're actually interested in what you have to say. And so one of the state reps was on that committee put forward a bill that is going to basically, there was a slight amendment to it that was actually a really good amendment and passed the committee. If this bill goes through, it hasn't happened yet, but if it goes through and it got through the committee, it will basically be the opposite of the Bit license. It will protect Bitcoin businesses from being regulated, including as money transmitters. So if you're taking money from someone to give, or taking Bitcoin from someone to give Bitcoin to someone else for some reason, which is sort of the classic money transfer definition, that will not require a license in New Hampshire. So basically, we'll do the opposite of what the Bit license does. So there's a lot of cool stuff on the horizon as we keep moving more Bitcoin and cryptocurrency activists to New Hampshire. Again, that concentration makes a difference. If a bunch of people go into a business and say, hey, are you taking Bitcoin yet? Especially if they're regular customers of that business owner isn't going to pay attention. If it's just one person who does it, well, maybe they're a cuckoo. So again, concentration makes a huge difference. The Bitcoin scene is incredible. So another cool reason to move to New Hampshire is all the media that we have. Of course, I do a show. It's called Free Talk Live. We're going to be recording throughout the weekend here. If you want to hear some interviews with the people who are speaking, we'll be doing that and we'll be talking. You know, we just talked to Jeff Corbett a little while ago. We got GM Griffin coming on. So if you want to kind of share with your friends who couldn't make it here, a little taste of what it's like, you can go to freetalklive.com. We'll have those shows up there. So it's not just my show. There's a show out in Portsmouth, New Hampshire. There's LRN.fm, which is my network. We got a bunch of great shows on there from all across the world. Jeff Corbin show in our cast is on that network. That originates from Keene. There have been television shows that are being produced. There's currently one TV show being produced in Keene called Citizen Keene by one of my co-hosts of Free Talk Live, Conan Saleh. Doing like more of a kind of a local show focusing on local issues in Keene, having guests in and talking to them, and that's on the cable access station. I'm on the board of directors of that cable access station. Now, the cable access, who cares about that? Well, in New Hampshire, a lot of people do. In New Hampshire, you know, cable access is like the only way to see any kind of local content. So it's actually really watched by a lot of people. So we've had a bunch of TV shows. We've had newspapers. Daryl Imperial does multiple shows. He's a killer activist. He's actually back in Keene, kind of keeping everything together in the studio. But he publishes a newspaper once a month and goes out and leaves it in newspaper boxes and people continue. So we've got an incredible level of exposure in the media, in addition to what I told you about before, where the mainstream media actually pays attention to us and actually writes news stories about the things we do. Give you an example. I put out a press release about the new Bitcoin vending machine that opened up in Concord. Concord Monitor runs a news story about it. The NH1, which is the other TV station, NH1 runs a news story about it. That's not news in any other place. Somebody puts a Bitcoin vending machine in a business, that's news. Well, in New Hampshire, it is. So we've got a kind of a liberty media empire there that not only reaches out to the globe to let everyone know, hey, come to New Hampshire. There's something special happening here. But it also reaches the people of New Hampshire with the ideas of freedom. Any secession fans in the room? Anybody like the idea of secession? Yeah, there's a lot of people in New Hampshire that like that idea. And I'm not just talking about the voluntarists or the anarchists. I'm talking about the people of New Hampshire. I did an outreach booth at the county fair in Cheshire County. And one of the things I was doing was passing out these NH Independence flyers from the New Hampshire Foundation, excuse me, foundation for New Hampshire independence, they made up these flyers that explained why we'd be better off if we left the United States. And they're very persuasive. Now, they don't use the term secession, they use the term independence, which is kind of a smart thing to do, secession. So we've got some baggage attached to it. But it's interesting handing these out to people and watching their reactions. You know, they're fair, they're kind of going from one place to another. You know, they're not stopping to really look at it, but as they'll read it, like their big grin like spreads across their face, they really are responding positively to that. Now, we haven't done any official polling or anything like that, you know, hiring a polling company, but it would be interesting to see, you know, what percentage of the population would already be open to these ideas. So we have the Foundation for New Hampshire Independence, which is doing some outreach about those ideas, and there's NHXIT, which is a more loose-knit group of activists, you know, showing up on signs and things like that. So we're getting all rolling on secession. So there's a lot of exciting things going on. I realize we're going on for probably about a half an hour now. I could keep going. There's a great documentary called 101 Reasons Liberty Lives in New Hampshire. 101 Reasons. You go to 101reasonsfilm.com and you can watch it. It's free. It's an hour-long documentary. Very interesting movie. Very persuasive. And it literally goes through 101 reasons in that 1 hour time. So it's like rapid fire. There's a bunch of really cool stuff that I haven't even touched on here in this speech. Here's another one for you. And I know this seems a little counterintuitive, but it's cold in New Hampshire. Yes, that's a reason why you should move. Now, why is that? I mean, I realize that I'm here in Acapulco trying to persuade people to move to the frozen tundra. I get it. It seems like a bad pitch, but here's why. Because no one wants to go where it's cold. And that includes the status. You know, a lot of people leave places like New Hampshire, a lot of status. It's warmer in Florida, and you can have plenty of state in Florida. In fact, a lot of people move from New York and other places like that down to Florida. And what do you think is going to happen when liberty continues to advance and these status continue to be frustrated? They want to grow the state, but it's getting smaller. They want to grow the state, but you know, they're leaving people alone more often. They're going to say, no, honey, it's fucking cold here. Let's get out of here. Let's go down to Florida or Virginia or somewhere else like that. Or if they don't want to go to Florida, they can just move to Massachusetts or move to New York, Vermont. It's right next door. There's plenty of other options for people that love this state. But one of the nice things about New Hampshire being cold is it sort of acts as a natural filter. We get the best activists because they're committed. These are people who are not only committed to pick up their lives and their businesses and their families and move to another place, but to move to a kind of foreboding and uncomfortable place sometime a portion of the year. Now, mind you, I think it's all very, very beautiful. I love the seasons. I'm originally from Florida. I get cold easy. I'm a little chilly right now in this room, okay? I don't like being cold, but what I do like is more freedom, and you're more free just by moving to New Hampshire in a classic way that people feel a little more free when they drive across the border, is you can take your seatbelt off, and no cop is going to pull you over for it. It's not illegal in New Hampshire. Just one of those little things. There's a lot of little things like that about New Hampshire that are very, very special, and that really set it apart. So I recommend looking closely at this idea, talking with your friends, talking with your family about it, really thinking about whether or not you're making progress where you are. Because if you want to make progress for liberty, being with other people who believe these ideas really helps. So I'm happy to answer any questions about New Hampshire, my experience there, what happens. So you have your hand up first, and I'll just repeat your question back in case the can't hear folks can hear.
That's good, because I've lost my voice from talking over 3 days. But could you talk a little bit about the progress that you made otherwise, what these accelerating, what the projection is to have 10,000 people, 5,000 people, how many people are friends of the Free State Project and are on the ground, things like that.
So the question was about the progress. If you're closing that door, I appreciate it, sir. Thank you. Progress of the Free State Project. 10% move previous. And you know, how many will move sooner rather than later? I don't know, they have a 5-year window of time by their agreement to make that move. Let's be realistic, not all 20,000 are going to make it, right? So some of them died between the beginning of the Free State Project. Some of them probably changed their email address, moved. They're not getting, you know, not in touch anymore. They don't know that maybe the 20,000 has even been reached. So I'd say it's probably more realistic to expect 5,000 to 10,000 more people out of that. Regardless of the numbers of the Free State Project, you know, we're going to move beyond whatever their numbers are, because as New Hampshire continues to be more and more of a destination for freedom, as it becomes more obvious, because there's a lot of people in the Liberty Movement that don't even know that there's a migration to New Hampshire. So as it becomes more obvious, as we can get the word out there about, you know, here's all this good news, it's happening. Maybe we're going to get marijuana decriminalized this year. That's a very real possibility. The gun freedom, you know, all these things that we're advancing, libertarians getting elected. We just had a second in the nation libertarian state representative. That's in New Hampshire. There's one other somewhere else, I forget which state, but a Republican who was elected, very young guy, he's like 20 or 21 years old. He flipped his party registration to join the Libertarian Party. So again, this news is going to get out. Liberty-minded people are going to see it, they're going to see the success stories, and they're going to come. So how soon, how quickly are we going to reach 10, 20, 30, 50,000? I can't tell you, but the sooner more people move, the better. The more people we have, the more effective we're going to be. Did that answer your question? Okay. Next. You in the back, I think, for a second.
Yeah, so you speak a lot about moving to New Hampshire, which is quite easy if you're a citizen. US, but how about if you, for example, I'm not from the US, I have to go through the whole immigration process, how painful is that? Is that, maybe not worth it then, or what's your experience?
That's a good question. Obviously the immigration process sucks, and that's the federal government, we have to blame for that. Secession would help with that, but that's not going to happen anytime soon. All that said, there have been some people who've successfully done what you're talking about. I'm not intimately familiar with the process, but I did just meet a guy who was like one of the founders of the Libertarian Party of Russia, who moved to New Hampshire, and I asked him, you know, what did this cost? Because I've heard the horror stories about people having to hire attorneys and, you know, application fees, and the applications get rejected, and then they keep the fee, and then you get to apply again, and it's just, you know, on and on. He said he won the lottery so that he was picked as someone who could go. And he said it didn't cost him more than like $500 all told. So, you know, I guess your mileage may vary as far as how easy or difficult it is. You know, there are some ways that obviously make it easier, like marrying somebody in the United States. So that could be a way to possibly do it. It wouldn't surprise me if there were people within the Liberty Movement who would be willing to just marry people so they can come in. I don't think that's strictly legal, but I bet you would be willing to do that if you kind of asked around. And gay marriage is legal in New Hampshire, so we're worried about it. And there are a whole lot of libertarian women, but gay marriage is legal. And by the way, kind of an interesting note, it was Republicans who helped pass gay marriage in New Hampshire. So like when you think about what Republicans and Democrats typically are, you have to kind of get out of the typical box when it comes to the people in New Hampshire. You've got Democrats that own guns, and Republicans who support gay marriage. So, I hope that answers your question. Up front here.
So I can marry officially a gay person and become a US citizen?
I suspect you very well could in New Hampshire. That's, I mean, they supposedly have the same rights for marriage that gay folks do as certain folks.
Okay, now my real question. Quickly to you, we can talk about it later. I had many talks out of state. Let's talk about it later. My question is, I just entered 10 minutes ago, but I consider like finding a new home right now. I'm free and I'm a programmer and I need to work remotely. So do you have good internet and do you have women, you know?
Sure. Well, you know, it's like 51 or 52% female. It's a college town, so there's actually a lot of women there. The question was about internet and working remotely. Most of the movers that I've seen are like IT people who can't locomotive speeds. Time Warner just got taken over by another company called Spectrum, and I've got business class in Keene. I had 50 megabits down. I doubled that to 100 megabits down, 20 megabits up, and they lowered my price, which was pretty sweet. So, yes, internet is available.
Can I just move there with a van, or do I need to rent in the free state?
So, the question is, could he move with a van, or does he need to rent? Well, it's going to get a little cold to live in a van, but my friend Darlene Perry actually lives in what he calls his not-a-bus, which was a bus, but I guess legally, if you remove seats from the bus and it doesn't have more than 16 seats, it's not legally considered a bus. So he removed enough seats from the bus, put it in like a bed in there, and he lives in that during the wintertime, which is really hardcore. But what he does is he's got like little these battery warming packs. They're basically a battery that creates heat rather than electricity, and he tosses a couple of those into a sleeping bag down the bottom of the sleeping bag. Keeps his feet warm at night, keeps the whole sleeping bag warm. So he's literally out there, you know, the middle of the winter in this omnibus, and he lives out there. So it is possible to live in a van if that's the way you want to live. Obviously, you have to find a place to park it. But there's plenty of people with property who are more than happy to usually, you know, let you rent a little spot. So yeah, you can just show up and make it work. That has worked for people, although obviously I recommend having some savings so you can take care of yourself. And, you know, these are very self-reliant people. They're willing to help, but they're not willing to, you know, take care of somebody forever, right? So you gotta be able to take care of yourself for sure.
Thank you.
By the way, I know we're over time, but I think there's a break now, so I can keep answering questions, right, Doug?
Well, if you don't mind me doing some work back here.
Please, come on up here. Doug Stricker, everybody. There's a tax on you're going out to dinner, but it says on the shelf, it's the price you pay. So because New Hampshire doesn't have all those taxes, they do build most of their state into that property tax. But even so, I've talked to people from New York and other areas with high property tax, and New York's property tax is higher. Plus they've got income tax, plus they've got sales tax, plus they've got
nice.
Yeah, it's pretty nice. And it's very hard to pass new taxes in New Hampshire. So there are people that want to pass an income tax, and they keep trying. The state is pitching the income tax, but it never goes forward. Just like the seatbelt ban never goes forward. It's just one of those things where if you want to get elected in New Hampshire, you better be against the income tax. It's just a fact. Even some of the Democrats will take the anti-tax pledge in order to get elected in New Hampshire. Who else has a question? I saw someone else with a hand up. Oh, well, before we get to you, anyone else has an ask question? Yes, a question about veganism, farmers markets in New Hampshire. Buying local is big in New Hampshire. Local wars, they're calling it, people who eat local food, that's big in New Hampshire. Farmers markets in Keene, there's two a week. It's Thursday and it's Saturday, I think. That's during the warmer season. I believe they have an indoor version during the winter time, so they still have it during the winter. It's just indoors somewhere. I don't know where that is. But yes, the answer is yes. There are a lot of farmers markets. Martin might want to speak to that. He's really into that scene.
Yeah, I know. I'm having pigs and we have a large garden. We're part of a CSA, so we get all of our food, vegetables and meats. We get some stuff at the grocery store, but vegetables and meats are produced right in New Hampshire, and in most cases, within 20 miles of my farm. So I trade with farmers for beans and that sort of thing, so you can absolutely do that.
All right, anybody else
who
hasn't asked a question yet? Yes, sir. We are doing not a live show, but we're recording interviews and then we're sending the segments to our network. The reason why we're not doing a live show is because we do a night show, Free Talk Live, and basically conferences like this tend to wrap up around the time when we start the show. So having done this a lot in the past, like Bitcoin conferences, it can be difficult to talk to Google and say, GM or Griffin, and say, hey, can you come back at 8 p.m. so we can interview? So it makes it hard to organize. So we're not going to be live, but we will be recording the show live to take, basically, sending that over to the network. Sort of voluntary show.
I was wondering, with the ongoing centralization of power and, more power to the federal government, how difficult is it to achieve more freedom in a small state with just 1.4 million people when a lot of things are being decided at a federal level?
Question about federal power and things being decided up there, and how hard it would be to change things at the state level. I don't really pay much attention to what happens with the federal government. I really don't care. I focus on the area that I can change, which is New Hampshire. We can make a difference there. We are making a difference there, which is why we are getting the opposition that we've been getting. We are having tremendous success in New Hampshire, and the more success we have, the more successful we'll be in pushing back against the federal government. There's a lot of people in New Hampshire who appreciate the idea of nullification, of telling the federal government no. In fact, New Hampshire was, I believe, one of the only states who said no to real ID way back in the day. Now, unfortunately, they did just this year create a real ID compliant ID, but it's optional. You can still choose to have the regular New Hampshire ID, and the federal government is saying that in 2020, if you have the regular New Hampshire ID, you won't be able to fly. But they've been saying that for a long time, and they keep putting the date off further and further. So that's an example, one of many, of how New Hampshire has said no to the federal government. Another one would be the seatbelt law. If we were to pass that seatbelt law, the federal government would give the state of New Hampshire tax dollars. But we've said no. That's the state of government. The state government has said no to that. So, we don't have the seatbelt law, and we're not taking, the state's not taking the money there. So that's another way, another example.
private rooms and everyone is like anarchists. I imagine this is super cool.
There are, the question was, are there anarchists renting a house and there are rooms? Everyone's an anarchist. Yes, and more than one of them. There are plenty of these places where I live in Keene. The house across the street is also loaded up with really friendly people. So there's more people on my street corner who care about freedom than there were in all of Sarasota, Florida, where I'm from. So yes, it is a very cool thing to literally live next door to people. In Manchester, there's like a whole neighborhood, Pete, you lived over in this area before. There's multiple houses. I don't know if they're all next door to one another, but there are a few that are. But in this one neighborhood area, there's, I don't know, how many, you want to take a crack at it, Pete? Dozens of people. I mean, over 50 people, you know, that are living in close proximity to one another, where you can walk a few houses down and there's more anarchists. So that's what it's like, and that's what it's like today. You know, we can get thousands more to move, it'll be even better. So I think I've completely exhausted all the questions at this point. Thank you all for being here and for paying attention and asking all sorts of great questions. Again, I'm Ian Freeman. You can find me at freetalklive.com. I blog at freekeen.com, where we've been blogging about the New Hampshire freedom movement for more than a decade. So there's a long history of some of the really cool stuff that's happened. Once again, I want to encourage you to check out the 101 Reasons Liberty Lives in New Hampshire. Great documentary film. Just go to 101reasonsfilm.com and watch it free there. Share it. Let all your friends know about it. Another movie I produced was Derek J's Victimless Crimes Free. I also highly recommend that. Thank you. VictimlessCrimesFree.com. And I hope you all enjoy your lunch and the rest of the Acapulco. Thanks.
We'd like to invite you to visit freekeen.com. Freekeen.com features audio, video, and blogs chronicling the transition to a voluntary society. Freekeen.com also has comments and discussion forums so you can be heard. Freekeen.com.
I should be in Keene, New Hampshire with the Free Staters.